Take your Bibles and turn with me to Galatians chapter 3. As we are continuing a very long series, which I had warned you that we were going to do, and we are still just scratching the surface on New to Hebrew Roots. And as we're going through the different aspects of Hebrew Roots, we've been looking at all the tough sayings that are in Scripture that have to talk about the law, where so many people take Paul's writings and then some other writers of the Brit Hadashah and say we no longer need the law. And so far, we have done 28 of them. And all 28, after a close examination of what's being said, we have found that instead of saying the law is done away with, it's just the opposite, that we need to rely on the law because it is our guide, our help, our instructions from Messiah on how to rightly reach the destination that we should be striving for, and that's to be with Him. So this week, as we look into the Scriptures, the plaintiff, what the church at large is saying is this, is the law has nothing to do with faith. The law has nothing to do with faith. Therefore, if I'm saved by faith, then I don't need the law. And they get this from Galatians chapter 3, verses 11 and 12. But I'm going to back up and read verse 10 as well, because it really does apply here. Because why would Paul say one thing and then flip around and say something else in the same three verses that we're looking at? Listen to what he says in verse 10. For those who rely on the works of the law are still under the curse. For as it is written, cursed is everyone who does not practice everything which is written in the book of the Torah. He's saying those that are living by the Torah must live it the best of their ability, 100%. But he doesn't say in that verse not to live that way. He said, if you are living, and he's supposing that you are living that way. So if you are living a Torah life, you have to live it all. You can't just pick and choose what you want. Then he goes on in verse 11 and says this, and that no one is justified by the Torah before Yahweh is evident because the righteous shall live by faith. But the Torah is not made by faith, but the man doing these things shall live in them. Well, now he's talking about the man who does these things are supposed to live in them and do so in faith. There's something happening here. And what we like to do in Christendom is we like to slice and dice the passages of Scripture so it fits the way that we want to. So here's the problem that we're finding is that in today's dogma of theological driven main theology, they've adopted in the last 150 years, last 200 years, the definition which you will find on your papers here from the Webster's Dictionary. And listen to what it says. I'm going to read all the definitions for you. The first one is it's allegiance to duty or a person. So speaking of loyalty. Fidelity to one's promises. We love to use this one in the marital status. You know, you have a fidelity to your promises in your marriage. There's the sincerity of intention. Another definition is belief and trust in and loyalty to God. It is belief in the traditional doctrines of religion. Notice it says doctrines. Doesn't say anything about the Word of God. Then it says a firm belief in something for which there is no proof or complete trust. That's the one that we gravitate to. That's the one that we try to say, well, this is what faith is. Faith is a belief in something which there is no proof. And I'm telling you that this is wrong. I know the dictionary tells me that's what the definition is, but I'm about to blow that out of the water and show you that that is not true at all. The third thing is something that is believed, especially with strong conviction, especially a system of religious beliefs like the Protestant faith. So the church today has adapted this philosophy that says this. And you notice I'm saying it's a philosophy. It is not scriptural. But they say faith is abstract, that you cannot in any way find any proof or evidence as we look at Galatians. And as we look at Galatians, we see that the main theme that he's talking about is how we acquire salvation. Salvation is life. The opposite of salvation is what? Death. Those are the two premises. In the Garden of Eden, when Adam sinned, when Eve sinned, what did they receive as a compensant for their sin? Death. They have now the realization, I sinned, now I will die. And they didn't know what that meant. They had no idea. They didn't know that they were going to live a lifespan where this body gets old and starts to fall apart, and you wake up in the morning and you go, whoa, where did that pain come from? Oh, I married her. No. That's just a shoulder. Oh. Life has everything to do with salvation. Salvation always talks about life. Everything void of that is death. So when we look at Scripture and we talk about salvation, we're talking about how we receive life. And what is life? Life is being in Yahweh. It's being in the Messiah. It's being a follower of Him. That's what life is, because without Him, death is separation from Yahweh. And so when you die, you are separated from Him. You cease to exist, because in Him you have life and breath. Without Him, you have nothing. When He chooses to take your breath from you, you die. You cease to exist. So it's important as we start unlocking the concept of what faith is to understand that what Paul is writing here has to do with how do we obtain this life? What is salvation? What do we need to be saved from? And so all these things are added into it. So when we look at this definition, the modern definition, they say, well, faith is an abstract. You don't need proof. Because faith is just a feeling, and I get so frustrated. I'm going to show you in a few moments how I do a little bit of Bible study in this. And as I started to look up faith, and I look it up in the dictionary to find out what faith is, I come up with something abstract. And they use terminology that when you go into even the Strong's Concordance and look at it, they run around in circles. They don't give you a definition of what faith is. And then in seminary, they teach this definition that it's an abstract feeling, that it's nothing that you have to worry about having any proof for. And I'm like, I don't get that. So you go to the Strong's and it says, faith is believing and trusting. Okay, so what is believing? You go to Strong's and believing is having faith and trusting. Okay, so what is trusting? Trusting is having faith and belief. And then there's no definition. That's what they give you. So you're running around in circles and you have no idea. And you go to seminary and you get educated like I did and you get a PhD, which means absolutely nothing. I got another piece of paper that just sits in the desk somewhere. I have no idea even where it's at. And I get all this education, and I have all this time that I get to think and answer the questions, and they teach me faith is just a feeling. It's abstract. It's something out there that I believe God's going to do this, and He's going to do all this, and I have no part in it. And that's what they teach faith being. But that is not what Scripture teaches. And so tonight, before we can even get into the rest of it, like the narrow way here, there is an end result. There is a goal. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. It has to be through Him. There's a path that we're on, the journey. Wide is the road. It's all over here and it's all over here that everybody else is going. But those that are going to make it to the end result, to the goal. Paul talks about it often. I press toward what? The mark, the goal. What sense is it to play football if you don't have a goal in mind? You want to score a touchdown. You want to get past the goal line, right? And what would it be like to have all the football players out there, two teams, and if you went sideways, you could get a goal? If you went to their end zone, you could get a goal. If you passed the five-gold line, the five-yard line, you got points. That would be utter chaos, and our Father is not a God of confusion or chaos. He said, here's the road. So I put two pieces of tape on the floor so you can realize, here's the road. Where am I? Where am I? Is that proof? It is proof. You can see it with your eyes. I'm off the road. Where am I? What am I doing? I'm being a normal Christian. Ooh. He says, if you're lukewarm, I'm going to throw you up. I'm going to spew you out. Be here or be here. This is going to get you nowhere. And yet, this is what the church teaches. I can have faith that God's going to do it all for me. And that's not what Scripture teaches. That's what doctrine teaches you. That's what religious institution teaches you. That's what most colleges today teach you. And I could name some of those colleges because I know some of the professors there. So we're looking for proof. Is there proof? Everybody wants to know proof. Well, let me just throw out to you what James Yaakov has to say. In James chapter 2, verse 17, he says, faith without works is death part of salvation? It's the opposite of it. So if you have salvation, you have life. If you're alive, which you don't seem to be tonight, you didn't get enough Shabbat sleep today, or you're afraid to talk to me. Okay, life, folks, is breathing. It's moving. You can see it. You know I'm alive. Why? I'm moving. I'm breathing. Now, if I had two X's over my eyes and was in a box, I would not have any life in me. I would be what? Faith without works, Yaakov tells us, is what? Can you have faith without works? But where is he getting it from? Because Paul just said in Galatians that the Torah, the law, which is what people call works, isn't what faith is. And so there's a dilemma. It's because they're not understanding what Paul is saying here. Paul is trying to teach us that the law is static. It is set. I have been walking all over the front up here. How much of those blue lines moved? Who's moved? Guess what? The law is God's instructions that does not move. It doesn't change. It remains the same. Who changes? I do. You do. According to your concepts, your precepts, and where your thought processes take you, you either say, yeah, I want to be on the road. But my friends are doing this. I think I'll go over here and do this for a while. But then I want to come back here. But I like these people over here. They're so friendly. I want to come over here. But okay, I know I should be back here. Not everybody's on this road, so I'm going to come back over here and be with my friends, you know, because I like it over here. I know I need to be here. At what point in our lives does the law, the Torah, the Word ever change? When does Yahweh, when does His Son Yeshua change? Never. Never. I don't care if it was 1751. I don't care if it was 350 AD when scholars and men said, well, I think what God was really saying is that the road really should be over here. So if you're over here, you're still on the path. You're okay. Because it's close enough. It's good enough. But what's the problem? I'm not on the road. If I'm not on the road, guess where I'm not going to make it to? The goal, where Yahweh says the road leads. No matter how close I get, I can be just about 45 hairs.
I'm really close.
And if I'm this close, I'm okay, right? Come on, I can lean over. I'm pretending to be a good Christian, but I'm acting like him sometimes. I'm doing pretty good, right? This looks really weird, doesn't it, Stephen? You have one leg just stuck out there. If you're not on the road, then you are not in his will. His will is his instructions for you. What does all that have to say about faith and salvation and the definition and proof? We're looking for evidence. That's what proof is. Is there evidence in faith? Well, let's look at what the opposite of faith is. We say that the world says today that faith is simply an abstract feeling, that there's nothing concrete. But if I say someone is unfaithful abstract? Have you ever heard someone say, well, there's no concrete evidence or proof that someone was unfaithful, but they're unfaithful. It's just an abstract feeling I have. Does that make any sense at all? So why would it make sense to say that being faithful is abstract and has no proof? I mean, look at my relationship with my wife. Everybody here knows that I'm married. People on the internet think I'm married because they've never seen her. I've had people write me, is your wife there? Really? Yeah, she's right there, but they still can't see her. They have to trust me. So is this relationship real just because they can't see her? But they can't see her. Oh, well, their loss. My gain. See, the relationship is based on faith that I'm married to her. Just because I got a piece of paper and I said, I will or I do, I don't even remember what I said. I think it was, oh my. It was something on that wonderful day. And we have been married ever since. But guess what? Where am I at? I'm right up here off the road. Sorry. Whew. I'm standing in front giving you guys a lecture, teaching, or whatever. And my wife is back there. We are two different individuals, but we are bound together by a covenant relationship. She's my wife. You know what that means? Guys, that person is off limits. That means girls, this guy is off limits because there's a covenant between us that is unspoken and spoken. That if girls, you come and you start flirting with me and my wife finds out, she grows nails. She comes and she protects her man. And that's exactly our role. Now, is that proof or is that just abstract? That's proof, right? But now let's look at the other side of that. What if I was to commit adultery against her and I was unfaithful? Well, don't look at me that. I said, what if? Okay? So you're looking at me like, she don't need the knife. I'm going to help her. All I have to do is just say the words, faithful or unfaithful. But when I say unfaithful, boy, all these feelings do arise, but then there's evidence. Evidence. When you say someone's unfaithful and you have evidence, then you can prove their faithfulness or unfaithfulness. If you can't prove it, then they are faithful. They're going to be one or the other. The evidence of whether or not you are faithfully walking the way Yahweh wants you to walk is because you're following his instructions, the path that he has set before you, which is very narrow. And the rest of the world likes to do this or spend most of the time over here or over here. And occasionally, when it feels good there. But when this becomes hard, why do you eat kosher? Well, you know, I guess a little ham ain't going to hurt anybody on Easter. How about some shrimp? I love shrimp. I are one. I like shrimp. So, but no, it's not hard. It's a choice. So you got it. You're the only one, right? I love it. Stay with me. Oh, my computer went blank too. So we're looking at proof. James tells us that faith without works is dead. Okay. So being dead is the opposite of life. Salvation is the presence of life and is exhibited by faith. It's exhibited by faith. Something you can see. So this is what we do. It's something that we do. So what do we do? That is a really good question. And I want to do a little bit of, I'm going to jump ahead. Actually, we're going to go to page 3 and we're going to skip out of here. And we're going to look at how I bounce around in Scripture sometime. We're going to go into my Bible study here, and we're going to look at the word faith as we see it in several passages. And so you have some passages of Scripture there. But if you'll look up here, which I know it's kind of hard to read, but on this side you'll see I'm looking at the ESV because it has the strong concordance, and I can go right to the Greek and Hebrew quickly for you. So in verse 11, it says, "Now is the evidence that no one is justified before God by the law." The law does not justify anybody. Remember, we talked about the road is here. What justifies us? My faith to stay on the path, to come here. That is something that I do. But that is done by faith. So what is faith? Again, they tell us it's just we believe arbitrarily, and boom, we're in. We're saved. We're living by faith just because we have that. Well, when we go to the word faith here, we're going to go up and we're going to go into the key numbers here. And faith is the number 4102 of the Greek concordance. So we go over here, and here's the word. Pistis. It's from 3982. It's persuasion. It's a credence. It's moral conviction of religion, truth, or of the truthfulness of God, or a religious teacher, especially reliance upon Christ for salvation. Abstractly, consistency in such profession, by extension, the system of religious gospel truth itself. Assurance, belief, believe, faith, fidelity. I remember a few moments ago I told you when we look at it, those are the definitions that we're gonna get for it. So it really hasn't defined what faith is yet. It tells us to believe, it tells us to trust, it tells us to have fidelity, okay, which is all pretty good, but it didn't tell me very much. So let's go back over here. I believe it is in Habakkuk, that one little minor prophet there that has powerful punch to it. Chapter 2, verse 4, it says, "Behold, his soul is puffed up, it is not upright within him," talking about the pride of the person, how he exalts himself to be something that he is not. He is not living righteousness, it's not in him. "But the righteous person," who's the opposite of this other guy, "shall live by his faith." And the word faith here is in the Hebrew 530. So let's go over to the Hebrew Strong's and look up 530. Amuna. Very nice. You want to tell somebody they have faith? Amuna. You have faith. And it simply means, from the feminine 529, literally firmness, figuratively security, morality, fidelity, a faithful or being faithful or faithfulness. It's a set office, stability, steady, truth, truly or verily. So did it really define it? Not really. It's given some characteristics of what faith should look like, but it still hasn't defined it for us. So even looking back in Habakkuk, trying to figure it out doesn't work either. But it says it's from 529. So let's back up and look at Amun, which is the primary, the letters here for faith. It's established, figuratively, trusty. Also abstractly, trustworthiness, faith, faithfulness, or true. We're not getting any closer here, but now it says to go to 539. So let's go up here to 539. And this is some of the stuff that I do to try to figure out if we can get the concrete stuff here that we're looking at. And at 539, it says aman. A-M-A-N. It's a primary root. Those are going to be the three primary roots in the Hebrew. So now we've taken it from all the different meanings that it could mean and bring it down to what the primary root of faith is. And it's to build up or support, to foster as a parent or nurse, figuratively to render or be firm or faithful, to trust or believe, to be permanent or quiet, morally to be true or certain. It's used once in Isaiah 30 verse 21, interchangeable with 541, another reference here, to go to the right hand, speaking of who's at the right hand of the Father. So we go to the right hand, so we're going to Yeshua. Faith is going to him. So there's a little bit of sustenance here that I see, but most people would miss that because we don't think when we think of right hand that this is an idiom speaking of the right hand, the majesty of Yeshua. So some of these things may not just commonly come to us. It comes through study in the Word of God. Hence, assurance, believe, bring up, establish, to be faithful. I mean, it just goes on and on. To trust and to turn to the right. Now it's getting a little bit more of something that we can do. Faith is turning to the right. Not to the right, but turning to what is right. Truth. And his word is truth. Yeshua is truth. So we're turning to him again, going back to the right hand of power. So we look at all this, and I still came away going, but what is faith? What is it? So I chose to go back to hermeneutics, because hermeneutics is our friend. Hermeneutics was my freshman year of college. And when you go into ministry, they tell you if you're going to be a minister, you have to take hermeneutics. And hermeneutics, I hated it because they said, Gary, you'll never make it because you don't have a three-point sermon and you don't exegetically do this, this, and this, and this is what makes a minister. I didn't come out a cookie cutter. I broke their machine that did all the cookie cutters, and when I came out, it was like, whoa, we don't know if we should give a paper to this guy or not, but we're going to get rid of him. But they expect us to come out with this same system. And in hermeneutics, they teach you a lot of really good stuff. And one of the things they've taught us, that when you come to a word that you don't understand and it doesn't make sense, you go to the very first time it's used in Scripture and find out what is the context around that word and what that word means. And generally, 99% of the time, what that definition usage of it is throughout Scripture is then going to be the benchmark. So every time that you want to know what it is, you can go back to that reference point as being your dictionary, your reference of understanding. We do that when we talk about, well, did the dietary laws change? And when we have to find out what food is, we go back to what Yahweh defines food, and that's what food is. And he defined it, and that settled it, whether it was 4,000 years ago or whether it was this week when you bought groceries. Food is not what God said isn't food. It's only what he says it is. So as we were looking at this process, I started going back, and I'm going to bounce back here. I've got a mess up there, I know. But when we go back to Scripture and we look at, I typed in the word faith. And so this is the first time faith is used. It's used in Exodus 21 and verse 8. And it talks about faith. And so I'm going to key it in as we look at the Hebrew here. Look at how many English words it takes to define the Hebrew words. So when we look at the English, it says, if she does not is the first Hebrew word in that sentence. Please her master. So far in Hebrew, all you have is not master. Who has designated for her for himself, then he shall let her be redeemed. So I've only got four Hebrew words that's taking how many English words? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. 20 words of English to define the four Hebrew words. So you can see how come it's so difficult when we're reading English if we don't even understand what the Hebrew's saying and we don't understand what the English is saying, we become very confused. So just as in hermeneutics, it teaches us to go back to the very beginning, let's go back to the ancient Paleo-Hebrew And actually, before the Paleo-Hebrew, to the most ancient of the Hebrews, which is both Otiot, Hebrew, Paleo. And let's look at the word faith. The word faith is aman. And it reads, of course, our Hebrews reads from right to left. So you have Aleph, Mem, and Nun. The ox, the water, and the seed. And so when you look at the word faith, this is what faith is. This is what's beautiful. I teach in pictures. When I talk about the road and you see me walking now, you're thinking, even though you're not thinking, I'm off the road. Now he's on the road. It was a subliminal thought, but it's a picture that you can see and relate. Ancient language was that way. They talked in pictures. And so faith started out with an ox head. The ox head represents what? It represents God the Father. It represents leadership, a stronghold. He is the alpha. He's the beginning. He's the leadership. That's why when you see Scripture and you read the name of God, even in a very literal sense, is El, it's what? Aleph Lamed. The Lamed is the shepherd, the one who guides you, so you have the strong one who's guiding and you, leading you in the right ways. That is who God is, the divine almighty, who is guiding us and leading us life. Why? Because we have a path that he gave us. So, and faith, it starts out with God. He's the head. He's the strong one. He's the one who's leading us. The second is Mem. Mem looks like waves. It has to do with water. Also has to do with blood, the blood of Yeshua that was shed for us. So you have the water that represents the word, and then you also have the blood of the Messiah. So Mem talks about how through Yeshua, in his shed blood and through his word, we can have the leadership of Yahweh. This is what faith is, okay? This is what faith is because of Messiah Yeshua and because of his word instructing us, we can have a right relationship with the strong one, the God Almighty, the divine, who is what? The next one is Nun. Nun has to do with growing seed. It has to do with heirship. It has to do with being grafted in, Romans 11. We have become part of his. And we read in the Brit Hadashah that we become heirs of Messiah Yeshua. We are his children. Faith, then, isn't abstract. It's us coming to a realization that we are in, because of Messiah Yeshua, we are in the God household. We have tabernacled, which is what grace is. We have come into his house as his child, and we are underneath his leadership, his ruling. That's what faith is. Now, does that sound abstract to you? That is very pointed, isn't it? Now, all of a sudden, when you think of faith, you're not thinking, oh, well, faith is just one of those, you know. No, it isn't. Faith is having a belief in God because of his son Yeshua and the instructions that he's given us, that I have become in right relationship with him. That's what faith is. Now, faith is both a noun and a verb. And we're going to talk about that in just a few moments. It's in your paperwork. But before we go to that, there's another word that's used for faith. And this has to do with the faithfulness of Yahweh. So there's some things that change. The last thing that changed, let me give you the passage of Scripture first. It's in Psalms 146 and verse 6. I'm going to exit out of here and go right into my concordance here. It said, blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Yahweh of God. Verse 5. Who, speaking of who he is, Yahweh, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever. Who keeps faith forever. So what changed as far as his faith compared to our faith is this one little letter here, the Tau, which is the cross, is at the end. So our part is to be inheritance, to be children, by being obedient to God the Father through the shed blood of Yeshua and keeping his word. Yeshua's part of the covenant was to go to the cross so that his blood can make a difference. And he was faithful in doing his part. So there's two different faiths. You have to have his faith and our faith. That is called a present tense verb. That's where you have two verbs coming together, colliding together, making a tense out of it. Not tense, T-E-N-T-S, but T-E-N-S-E. So, now that we've got all that straight and you've got your English all straight, where does faith come from? We read in Ephesians 2 and verse 8 that that faith comes from Yahweh. So even for us to have the ability to have faith, which is not just an abstract, but it is believing in him and being obedient to him and being called into relationship, we are now become heirs and children of his. It's his doing, not ours. Ephesians 2:8 says, "For by grace you have been saved." Grace, that tent that we get to enter, his home. "By grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of Yahweh." It is Yahweh who's given you this gift. He is one who gives you the ability to even exercise faith. He's the one who establishes it and sets us up so that we can even make the right decision. Without him, without the Ruach, without his Spirit bringing us to the point of realization that we need him, and in giving us faith, we can't even make the right decision to come off the path onto the path. Now, I have this underscored specifically so that you could understand when you look at the Greek here in Ephesians. Look at all the different words that we had to add in. Only the underscored are actual Greek words that are being translated. "For grace, been saved through faith, and this, not your doing, gift God." All the other stuff was added in so we could complete an English sentence. Otherwise, it wouldn't make sense to us. So when the translators are working to translate Scripture, these are some of the obstacles they run across. That's why it's so important, as we have looked at each one of these, in understanding when Paul is talking about the law here, because the way English translates it from the Hebrew or from the Latin, for us to get complete sentences, for us to understand it, they add words so that we can have fluidly understanding of the text, what's being said. Otherwise, it doesn't kind of make sense to us. But that's why we need to go back and look carefully at what's being said. And don't trust the commentators. I just went through Strong's with you. I went to 5 different passages of Scripture. We looked at 4 different reference numbers in the Strong's on what faith is, and none of them told you as much as what the Paleo-Hebrew told you. In fact, all it told you was the same gobbledygook that we learned at seminary. Was it's in an abstract trust and belief. And it isn't. Faith is recognizing Yahweh as the Godhead, him and him alone. Through his Son who shed his blood for us, redemption. Through his word that gives us instruction, the Torah. Very right in the center of faith is his instruction, his word. It's the combination. It's both at work. It's his word, his instruction, and the work of his Son, the finish, the Ta, which happens to be the last letter of the alphabet. "I am the Alpha and Omega," Yeshua says. He's the beginning and the end. So the consummation, the finishing of our faith is in him, and it can only be found in his word and in believing and accepting his blood as it was shed for us. That makes us seed, nun, heirs, sons, daughters. Ow! Now maybe that don't tickle your little get-go. It does mine. Okay, that is good stuff in that Scripture. You know, we get away from all the philosophy, we get away from all the doctrine, and we come back to the Word, and we understand that God has done all this so that I could be an heir. Is that not true? Wow. And you don't deserve it. And I don't deserve it. None of us deserve it. In fact, when you read Paul, he says, we're all filthy rags. We all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's why we have the blood. That's why we have the water, the washing, the regeneration to cleanse us, to bring us into right relationship, that we can worship Yahweh, the Father, through the Son. And we're heirs. But we're on this journey. We're not there yet. We're in the process of salvation. It's a journey. It isn't a one-time event. I didn't just get married one time on one particular afternoon and then, you know, that was it. No, we work at our marriage every single day. So let's talk about the law and socks. You know? No? It's very scriptural. It's very simple. I wanted to make it as simple as possible. All right? When we look at the duality of what takes place in the tenses, which is, I said I was going to get to, and did I skip over it? No, it's a little further down. So understanding law and socks, it's very simple. See, Yahweh's word, you're ready for this, aren't you? I can't wait. Yahweh's word is his instruction to us. This is his love letter to us, right? Okay, and there's certain expectations. He said, here's the road, narrow it is. And then he says, according to the church, all you have to do is have faith and trust Yeshua, and he's going to do everything for you. Then what do you do with Paul's statement when he says, you put on the full armor of God? Well, I thought Yeshua was going to do that for me. No, nope. He said, you put it on. I've given it to you. You put it on. That's your responsibility. I did mine. I'm the Tav. I died on the cross. My blood was shed. I've given you the written word. I've done everything I possibly can. There it is. What are you going to do with it? This is what faith is. Faith, because Yahweh comes to me and says, Albert, I'm God, and I'm bringing to you the means to have a relationship with me that will bring you life, not just here, but eternal life. Here's the instructions, my word. All you have to do is believe and trust and accept that. Do you accept it? Amen. See, you had to make a choice. I offered it. It was a free gift. And this is what faith has to do with the law. Everything. But what does the law have to do with faith? Everything. We say that the law doesn't. Does the law save me? Does this road save me? No, it's a road. The law is instructions. It gives me the right information to go where I need to go. So if there was a law in Scripture that says this, thou shalt wear white socks. And I was just introduced to that. In order to go to heaven, Albert, I have to wear white socks. It says so right in the Word. Well, I believe that. That's the Word. And because Yeshua died and he tells me I should wear white socks, then I should wear white socks. And the church says, well, not necessarily, because he's done all that for you. You don't have to do anything. Oh, well, if he's done it all, then I guess my black socks are okay. I don't have to worry about white socks because Yeshua did it all. But now I have a dilemma. I have a problem. The Scripture says, if I truly love Messiah, if I truly want to accept the gift that he's given me, then in order to be on the path that leads here, one of the steps I have to take, I have to put on white socks. That's a commandment. It's an instruction. It's a means to get me where I need to go. See, because white socks represent a clean, pure person. And so I need to have clean feet on the path to take me to where I need to go, which is to be with the Father. So I need to have clean, white socks, but I have a problem. I like my dark socks. These are nice socks. Everybody's wearing a sock that they like. Some have colored socks. I mean, after all, they're just socks. It's just food. It's just a moedim. What difference does it make? It's only a sock. Why do I have to do it? I have faith that Messiah has done all this for me. No. He's done all that he could do. He shed his blood to pay for your crimes. And he says, if you accept this, then you need to wear white socks because it's instructed. It is the process. It is, I'm looking for obedience. It's me saying to my wife, I am only going to love you from now on. It's just one of those rules. Now, I don't know what to do except for either obey or disobey. He says, wear socks, but the church says I don't need them. Those look fine. You look good in them. Your feet are nice and toasty in there. And nobody wants to see your feet anyway. But Yahweh says you need to wear white socks. Faith in today's vernacular would simply say, well, let's spiritualize that and let's just make it abstract in a feeling. My feet are clean and they are white. And so I must be okay. And Yeshua has done everything for me, so I don't need to do it. That's today's definition. But according to the definition that we saw in Paleo Hebrew, for me to be obedient to the Father, to have right relationship with Him, the water, the Word, instructs me, wear white socks. So, I take the white socks and I say, Yeshua, put them on for me. No, really. You do it. Oh, please. You take it all away. You do it for me. What does he say? You put on the socks. What does it say in Scripture when the evil forces come against us? Does it tell us to run or to stand firm? Oh, wait a minute. I thought Yeshua was taking care of all that. What do I got to stand firm for? He can do it all and I can run. No, see, there's a relationship here. There is a perfect tense here in two verbs coming together. What Yeshua Messiah has done and what we need to do. My responsibility is to take the socks. And even if the rest of the world doesn't like it, and you don't like my hairy legs, and you, not bad. Oh, air it out. And I am to put on white socks. There. What's the problem? One more. I didn't go all the way. We have a tendency to only do the part of the law that we think that we're supposed to do. Every single letter of the law is supposed to be obeyed without question. So you take the other one while everybody's looking and you work through the fat belly over the lap and... Look, fuzzies from my sock, toe jam. Ew. No one said life is pretty. No one said you weren't going to have difficult times. When you accept Messiah and you choose this path, people are going to look at you strange. And he has a PhD. But it's my responsibility to put it on. It's my responsibility to wear the Torah. It's my responsibility to be obedient to his instructions. And whether you agree with me or not, I don't care. And you don't need to care either. We need the midrash and we need to talk about it. We need to grapple over the things in the areas where some are further along in the journey and so they have a much better understanding. Me, I'm still back here at baby steps. I'm still learning Torah. I'm still learning what it means to be Hebrew. Someone who has crossed over, who's now on the path. I want to stay here. I don't want to be doing this. I don't want to be over here. I don't want to miss it altogether. Whoops. I don't want to miss it altogether. It's hard to get all this up that far now. When I was younger, I was like a deer who could jump. That's the word. I thought my name was Gary, but anyhow, it's my responsibility. This is part of the covenant. This is part of the verb. That's my part in that perfect tense. He did everything he was supposed to do, and now I'm supposed to do everything I possibly can do. I give 100% to Tina, but she could still reject me. She gives 100% to me, but I could still reject her. That's part of a relationship that's hard. And so what God has given 100%, and we sometimes give a little bit to try to please him. Come on, folks. Get in or get out. Get saved or be lost. Go to heaven, the mark, or go to hell. Those are the choices. I know that sounds abrupt and rude, but the law, the instructions that he has given us is so that we reach the goal of spending eternity with him, that we have life. And it isn't something that comes after death. That's when the full manifestation of life is given to us. We are right now a kingdom people. When Yeshua 2,000 years ago taught his disciples how to pray, he said to them, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in the future when you die and you've been made holy." You know, when it's all, you can do whatever you want now, but when you get there, I will make you right. No, he says, just as it is there now, you need to be behaving and acting and following my instructions as if you were here with me now. Because when it comes time for us to be judged, and oh yes, we will all be judged. And we will give an account of whether we were here, or whether we did this. Stay on the path. Faith is from him. He gives it to us. It is a noun and it is a verb. It is two people coming together. The person of the Godhead, Yahweh, his son, teaching us his instructions on how we can get on the path. And next week, we're going to use this thing right here and illustrate that taking faith that he has given us and taking the instruments of his instructions on the pathway, and what that looks like, so that you get an understanding of how law and faith work in unison. Okay? So that's for next week.